don't have to be there. They don't have to take your call. They don't have to take your meeting. They don't have to do, they're volunteering their time, whether it's 30 seconds or 30 minutes. Everybody you come in contact with is a volunteer. Unless you're locked in a jail cell and the person coming in to talk to you is a police officer, a jail guard, or an investigator, you're not there against your will. Everybody is a volunteer, and respect that. They don't have to deal with you. So reputations develop when people disregard this concept, when they think that somebody has to take their call, has to answer their questions. Everybody is a volunteer. Everybody is somebody's somebody. So treat them as such. Work on communication skills. That was number three. Number four, understand where loyalties lie in the transaction. This is really important for appraisers because I think quite often appraisers misunderstand where loyalties lie and the kind of maybe the power that they think they have or don't have. Understand where loyalties lie. Realtors owe their loyalty to their client. Attorneys owe their loyalty to their client. They don't owe any loyalty to you when you call them up as an appraiser or as a lender. They owe their contractual duty, their contractual responsibility, what they signed when they signed a listing agreement and or a buyer's agency agreement. They owe their duty, their loyalty to their client. So when we call up and we ask questions, we have to understand that they may not be able to answer everything, and they're maybe withholding some information out of respect for their client. They may have to do that. We have to respect that. We have to understand that. And for appraisers, our client is typically the lender in most transactions. Of course, we have private deals where the lender is not where there is no lender, where the lender is not our client. But in most federally related mortgage transactions, of course, the lender is typically our client, and that's who we owe our loyalty and our responsibility to. And sometimes we have to withhold. We can only share information with our client, and there's some things we can't talk about. So realtors need to understand that. Lenders, of course, need to understand that, that is our client. Regardless of who pays, it's not so much anymore, but it used to be in the old days that quite often we would collect a check from the person at the door when we showed up at the house. And quite often that would lead them to believe that they are the owners of that appraisal and that they are the client. And we would sometimes get in discussions with them about the fact that, no, actually the lender is our client. So just helps when all parties to the transaction understand where the loyalties lie in the transaction and they have some understanding and compassion and can appreciate why, who, what, where, when, and why those situations may occur. Number five, I wrote this down because I used to be a real estate agent. I have an innate, I guess, understanding of what they go through, both in terms of the training, the time involved, the money involved, what they have to do to prospect and get clients, time spent on the phone, time spent in the phone booth at the office, the time spent at open houses, the professional development, so on and so forth. Realtors work very hard to get the deals that they have. They work very hard to get the clients that they have. Of course, some of them just come through sheer name recognition or family connections or whatnot, but they still have to keep those people. If a realtor is a jerk, it doesn't matter if they know that people are not, people are not going to work with them. So realtors work hard. Lenders work hard to get the deals that they have, to get the clients that they have. Appraisers need to be respectful of the work that's put in to gain those clients by those industries. Sometimes there's chatter that goes around the appraisal industry that, you know, realtors don't do a whole lot and they get to nab 7% of the deal. Well, first of all, that's fallacious. It's not true because typically if there's a 7% commission or an 8% commission or a 5% commission on a deal, it's being split. It's being split between two different agents, unless, of course, there's a double dip situation. Or, of course, there's some that has to go to the brokerage, unless you're on a 100% deal with a particular brokerage, in which case your expenses are typically higher. So realtors are not just walking away with $14,000 on a $200,000 deal. They are typically getting paid more than an appraiser, but quite often there's a lot more work, a lot more time, a lot more effort, and a lot more risk that's taken for a real estate agent, and quite often by the lender, that go into deals than what an appraiser has to deal with. So it's important for appraisers to respect what goes into the training, the time, the effort, and the deals on the side of the real estate agent and the lender. You know, realtors aren't just raking in commissions for doing nothing. They have risk, they have expenses involved, they have goodwill building, they have professional development expenses and time, they have years of reputation building, and of course this is true for lenders as well. So appraisers, appraiser partners, don't be jealous of somebody else's commission. You know, if you want to be a realtor, be one. It doesn't really take that much to go out and get a real estate salesperson license. Of course, you have to find a broker to work with. Doesn't take that much to go out and be a lender. You have to find a good company to work with. But if you're jealous of the commissions, go out and do that. I know a fair amount of appraisers that are also licensed real estate agents. Some of them are actually lenders. Of course, there has to be some disclosure. You can't appraise your own deals. But if you want to do that, go do it. My recommendation is don't be jealous of somebody else's benefit. Don't be jealous of somebody else's blessing. It only puts a bad feeling in your own heart, and it doesn't serve anybody in the deal. Number six, I wrote down study other industries' practices. This is really a big one for me, not only because I've worked in many other industries, but because I am an owner of several businesses in several other industries, some of them not connected in any way, shape, or form, some of them loosely connected, like real estate investing and appraising. Study other industry practices. You know, pick up and apply things that might help your business. As I mentioned in the intro, I used to work in the hotel industry. This was when I was a 19, 20, 21-year-old kid living in Chicago, studying leadership development, martial arts, and business. And I was working at what was the Stouffer Riviera Hotel, which I think at the time was like a 4-star hotel, right in smack dab in the center of downtown Chicago, State and Wacker Drive. And I was about the lowest on the totem pole. I was in the guest services department, which was valet parking and bellhop and those kind of things. But it was a great, great education for a 20-year-old kid on how to deal with the customer. Of course, we learned the old adage, customer is always right. We also learned how to deal with clients, customers. Of course, we call them guests when they weren't right, but how to make it right. And I just learned a wealth of knowledge, information, and practices that I've carried to many other industries that I've worked in and been successful in the 20 plus years since that experience. So I strongly recommend reading, Googling, studying, listening to trainers, coaches, mentors in other industries. You may not be able to use everything, but of course you'll find nuggets of wisdom and practices that could be carried over. And of course, when you do, you tend to look like a pioneer in your industry when you bring some of those practices over. So that was number six, study other industries and practices. Number seven, also a carryover from the real estate industry, appraisers, work from scripts. I mentioned it earlier. It's point number seven, work from a script. Real estate agents, work from a script. Lenders, work from a script. I know some of you say, oh no, I'm so good. I'm a good talker. I can just let it roll off my tongue. You might be, but I still strongly recommend you work from a script. And this is for appointment calls, realtor calls for appraisers. When you're calling realtors, got to discuss comps. Just have a basic script. Doesn't have to be word for word. Although if you write it word for word and you practice it word for word, it's going to roll off your tongue as if it's not word for word or canned. It's going to roll off your tongue like it's just rolling off your tongue. This is the idea behind practice, right? To close the gap between not knowing something, not being trained up on something, and having it come across as innate or ingrained. That's why we practice things. Have a script for angry calls. Have a script for that angry caller. This is for appraisers. Whether it be the seller, the buyer, who doesn't agree with your appraisal, a lender or realtor that may not agree with your appraisal. We have to find a way to deal with these and to just touch on the angry call script. I strongly recommend, and I have one here in my office that I've practiced probably hundreds of times, develop a list of questions that'll help diffuse the situation when you get an angry caller. You got to diffuse the anger, get to the bottom of the real concern or the issue. And quite often the real concern or issue on an appraisal is not the value. That's usually what they say. But typically what it comes down to is the lack of control that they have. And it will sound something like, how could you, or how couldn't you, or are you crazy, or I've done this, this, and this to my house, and how did you miss all these things? And if you let them just kind of talk for a while and you listen and you respect that they need to vent, and they really probably called thinking you're not going to listen. And then when you do, it cools them down a little bit and allows them to open up and to vent. And then when you start in with your list of questions, your script, if you will, on what they're basing their questions on, it opens up a door to start discussing probably the misunderstood. The misunderstood for them is the appraisal process, the rules and regs with which we are bound quite often, the parameters, whether they be Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, lender parameters, underwriting parameters, that quite often they don't know. So they see things, they see adjustments, they see square footage, and they see these things. And I think quite often, at least with the calls that I've dealt with over the last decade, which are few, but we've all had them, quite often I think sometimes the angry person on the other end of the line has imagined a snarling Scrooge like individual sitting in an office, this is the appraiser I'm talking about, just waiting for the angry phone call that we can flip them off and swear at them and yell them and hang up the phone, all the while with a very devilish, ghoulish laugh, like, ha ha ha, we got them. And of course, it's not the case. Most appraisers, at least the ones that I know, the ones that work out of my office, are not that way at all. Always take the call, always listen, always discuss in a very professional manner. Even when the person on the other end of the line is maybe very irate, maybe using foul language, we've all coached each other on how to just kind of listen through that, let them vent, let them kind of work themselves out of their anger. Be empathetic. I wrote this down. Be empathetic, not sympathetic. Sympathetic is seeing your friend fall into quicksand and jumping in with them. Being empathetic is seeing your friend fall into quicksand and standing outside the hole, grabbing a branch and holding it out for them to save them. So there's a big difference. Don't jump into the quicksand with them by swearing and meeting them at their own level. Being empathetic means saying, "Yep, I can really understand that. I can understand how you feel. I'd feel the same way." You know, these kind of phrases. And then after you listen, you do your best to explain what an appraisal is, what it's not, what it's based on, what the limitations are, the guidelines with which we're bound in terms of reporting and comparable sales, so on and so forth. Quite often, in almost every case, in fact, I can't think of one that's been different. When we start to explain these things, when I start to explain these things, I typically get from the person on the other end of the line something along the lines of, "Oh, I didn't realize that. I didn't know you guys had to do that, or were bound by that." So, again, number seven, work from a script. So if you don't have a script to deal with those kind of things, whatever's going on in the day, whatever's in your head is just going to come out. And I don't recommend letting whatever's in your head on any given day be what drives you. Number eight, qualify your clients. Boy, is this a big one. This is another one that I can see crossing all industries. But for appraisers, I think might be a little difficult one to understand. Qualify your clients. You can't work for everybody, at least not and remain sane. You cannot work for every lender and every AMC. A, because many of them will not pay the fees that you may expect or require. I know that's true in my business. There's some business I just won't accept. I've drawn a line and I will not accept business below a certain dollar amount. I think it's damaging the industry. You can't work for everybody, meaning B, you just don't have enough time in the day. An appraisal business is typically based on you, the appraiser, getting out, inspecting the homes, coming back, sitting at the computer. Now, even if you have a staff like I do that researches data and has and can input data and help out with comparable sales and things like that, which allows me and my company to get out a lot more appraisals but than maybe the individual, even so, it still is dependent upon me going out and looking at the homes and doing what I am.